Our next speaker is Dietjes Stilwe from Luther Academy. He was born in the northeast of Latvia and was converted to Christianity at the age of 18. He finished the Sasis Music School. He's a trumpet player, so he'll be able to help out Gabriel someday. And then graduated the University of Latvia Faculty of Theology. Worked as a missionary pastor in several congregations in rural areas in Latvia. 2 years before leaving for the United States to do his doctoral studies, he was elected as provost of his deanery. He finished his PhD in missiology at Concordia Theological Seminary, Fort Wayne, in 2008, and currently is working as a pastor in Riga, also as an associate professor at the Luther Academy and chairman of the Luther Academy Senate. He teaches courses in New Testament, eisegesis and exegesis, missiology, the proclamation of the gospel, kerygma, world religions, traditional confessions, and non-traditional movements. He also co-authored 2 Latvian editions of the Encyclopedia of World Religion.
Trying to walk in the shoes of the reader of this particular subculture, is it gone too far or is it appropriate? My opinion is really a little bit too radical, not a little bit, quite too radical of the contextualization. So far we have come to understanding the contextualization. On one hand, it sort of should be done, on the other hand, it sometimes goes too far. And let's proceed. Contextualization, of course, has this root word context. And also contextual theologies, as a derivative of the word context, also are, I would say, the object of really great worries, I would say, in that way. And of course, there are also major voices in the theology who are saying that contextual theology, as a derivative of the sentences and context, is also presenting some kind of difficulty. There's a tendency in contextual theology to overreact, to make a clean break with the past, and deny continuity with one's theological and ecclesial ancestry. Bosch, David, very famous theologist, and he also says this should not lead to a critical celebration of an infinite number of contextual and often mutually exclusive theologies. This danger of relativism is present not only in the third world, but also, for instance, in Western historical political scholarship, where one sometimes gets the impression that each scriptural text is viewed as being so deeply shaped by its context that it actually constitutes an isolated theological world in itself. So this is also one of the caveats that we see related to the contextualization enterprise or contextualism as such. And I would say the most radical author, Balance, I mentioned before, he is very radically saying this. There is no such thing as theology. There is only contextual theology. Feminist theology, black theology, liberation theology, Filipino theology, Asian American theology, African theology, and so forth. Doing theology contextually is not an option. It is really a theological imperative. And to be frank, I think really if we explore those contextual theologies, we really can also find the roots where all those theologies which are mentioned here are coming from. And it's, on one hand, quite understandable. Theologians see the problem, some are oppressed, and some groups are suffering because of that. So they construct a theology based on this. this contextual issue. There is all kinds of theologies possible, but the root, in my opinion, is the same. It's putting emphasis on context and starting the theological inquiry from that, and building the whole theological structure from this situational context. The only kind of theologies that contextual theologies don't really agree with are traditional or classical or one could say dogmatic theologies. Of course, and we will talk about it more about traditional classical theologies and those contextual ones. Here's another, I would say, weakness of the contextual theologies, as I said, we'll talk about it more. Contextualizing theologies are transitory, even ephemeral, lasting for one day. They are related to specific historical moments, and so tend to exist for a short time only. They are matter of seizing opportunities as they arise, or of discerning what is necessary now, and for the immediate future. In that sense, they are opportunists, temporary and occasional. They are for this place and this point in time, not for somewhere else, or for the whole world, or forever. And this is the real problem with context, of course, because it changes all the time. So, if one has built the whole theological structure on this very slippery notion of context, then, as soon as the context changes, the whole theological structure has to be changed too. And for instance, this Clapsus Emmanuel, who is an Eastern Orthodox, Greek Orthodox theologian, he points out another difficulty of contextual theologies. Contextual theologies contain in themselves some dangerous tendencies. It is possible to accept or sanctify anything and everything in the name of contextual theologies and indigenous practices as genuine and legitimate forms of expressions of Christian faith and hope. And we may ask, why is it possible to sanctify anything and everything in the name of the contextual theologies? In another place, Francis says, sometimes reference to God is also called theology. And so it means really that you can include whatever you want as long as it refers to God. And I think that was what also Dr. Adamson mentioned before, that there is really quite a problem in that kind of a challenge. If theology is a talk about God, then really, yes, can be that person is referring to God says, oh, this is my theology. And of course, necessarily has to be a Christian theology. If we put the whole emphasis on contextuality, but let's look at the very beginning of contextualization. As it all started, and I think it has sounded like a snowball, a small snowball, and it has rolled. And currently, as I said, everybody is mentioning contextualization as an inevitable missiological and theological notion. Let's look at the very beginning. The whole contextualization theme started in World Council of Churches in 1972, 14 years ago. World Council of Churches at that time sponsored a committee university called Theological Education Fund. Chucky Cole was a leader, and they wrote a report called the Ministry Context. And then there they first mentioned this word contextualization. And in general, the concern was that the standards and structure of the Western degree-oriented theological educational system wasn't found to be relevant for the third world situations. Therefore, it was felt that it should be adapted to the context. Thus, the word contextualization came into being. Dr. Pill also mentioned this issue, which in my opinion really is a real issue and quite a hot topic, really. When we see how people learn in various cultures, we can inevitably see that there are some differences. But then, how far can we go and how flexible should we be in this adapting of the theological education? What was the theological background of this contextualization? In the document called Ministry into Context, TEF really claims to change Christian ministry, theology, and theological education in general. It is surprising that they mention missiological challenges. Missiological challenges are as the ones that cause all this rethinking of theology. I think every missiologist really should be aware also of the fact that somehow missiology is a discipline itself, and in my opinion it really should be under the theology, and theology has to be queen of the disciplines in that sense, and missiology should be like just a sub-discipline in my opinion. But the TES said that missiological challenges to bring the education also to the remote places of the world, they are the main reason why this contextualization has to be introduced, and why the whole theology has to be changed. The document states, it's important that we should be open to the signs of the time, especially in believing in the Holy Spirit. Believing that the current missiological challenges are the root of the radical rethinking of the ministry, of theology, and consequently of theological education as a whole. And that's where we see also rethinking of ministry. We could add also rethinking of pastoral ministry. And if to put it shortly, the challenge is really that pastoral ministry also can be just so made so dependent on context that a person could really, you know, lose the sight why the pastoral ministry is meant first of all. And for instance, a contextual thinker would say, oh, if a context requires that we don't have any pastoral ministry, then we shouldn't have it, because the context is what really sets the agenda for the whole theological enterprise. Another interesting thing is this initial document that Theologia Virtorum, or Theology of Pilgrims, is introduced there. And our thrust forward to Catholicity is at most and also at best through the Theologia in loco. So, context seems to imply two formidable tasks. One is the exercise of the role of critical appraisal, the role of self-determination, or the aims, content, and patterns of theological education seen from outside or from the past. The other is to redefine missiological priorities from inside, and to create new responses in theological education to the demands of mission. Mission here is to be looked at in the perspective of the vital and hope of the third world, its vital quest for self-identity, justice, and liberation. So you see how the whole mission of Christian churches reshaped to adapt it to the context, which is in the third world. So, on one hand, it's really understandable. On the other hand, it's really also dangerous, because once you go this way, where will you stop? Expressing it in a more condensed way, leaving out the less important details, T.F. said the following regarding the context. Context seems to exercise critical appraisal, to redefine sociological priorities, to create new responses to the demands of mission. So this is like, sometimes theologians also think, and maybe it's an area of philosophy or the two, but there is this notion as epistemological foundation. And I think in this 1972, there was the epistemological shift. And epistemology is all about how we, what do we use as a basis for doing theology, for instance. And yeah, some theologists are also agreeing with that and saying that yes, this emphasis on contextualization put a new epistemological foundation, which was not really there before. In my opinion, really, yeah, it's quite a change. And we'll talk about it more. This document also talked about incarnation and Lordship of Christ. Emphasis on the context usually is really putting emphasis on context is always very particular, very individual, and it sort of doesn't allow any metaphysical ideas even to be included, because what's the metaphysics in context? Usually people talk about, well, you know, I've got the situation and I have to adapt somehow to it, I think the authors of the document of TEF, they knew that they have to include some kind of doctrinal material there too, otherwise they would probably be charged about being too world-oriented. But incarnation is one of the doctrines that was involved or put in the document, and also Lordship of Christ. Although the main concern of the committee was related to the nature of theological education and thus educational by nature, the discussions that surrounded the idea of contextuality were also of theological nature. The most important in this region was the theologically significant notion of the incarnation. It for the authors of the document also served as a pattern or paradigm for contextualization. And if you read missiological literature, you always will see reference to incarnation. I mean, we ask, what's really the bridge there? Why contextualization and why incarnation? And as sometimes it's explained, that what did happen in incarnation? In incarnation, holy God, Son of God, went down to a particular, into a particular place, in a human body, which was very, very contextual in a sense. He was a male, then he lived in a particular time, he lived in a particular geographic location, he lived among a particular culture, he was influenced by the culture, and so on and so on. And usually those who support this contextualization enterprise, they say, oh, you see, information is just as contextual as it can get. And it is true, in my opinion, of course, the incarnation is contextual in that sense. But interestingly enough, this document doesn't really go further. The question is whether focusing just on the incarnation and the Lordship of Christ doesn't really reveal the whole story of Christ. It is theologically justifiable. In this respect, contextualization could be charged as being focused on the fragmentary perception of Christ's mission in the very document that created the notion. Although Christ did indeed incarnate himself into human flesh, that, together with his life on the earth, crucifixion and resurrection was just as he has lived here on the earth and a part of his mission. It is not the whole story. And it seems really that Ascension seems to have been very, very ignored and left out of the story. And I think for understandable reasons, because contextualization cannot really deal with those metaphysical, spiritual questions. Contextualization usually deals with the worldly matters, and somehow to include Ascension would really mean like putting showing the finger to heaven that okay, there is another reality which is really not subdued to the context of this world. And it's interesting, yes, that the authors of this document didn't put Ascension in the whole story of Christ in the document. I mentioned before that contextual theologies usually don't agree with the classical, dogmatic, or traditional theologies. And I think it's really helpful to see what is really at stake there and what is the difference between traditional and those contextual theologies. So first, on point of departure, dogmatic theology moves from revelation of God to the modern world. Contextual theology moves from the modern situation to revelation. So it's different direction. And if you sometimes think that, well, what a big deal, direction, different direction, no, but actually Reformation was questionable direction. Who is the main dealing or acting person? Is it God or is it human? And one side said, well, humanly, we try to achieve God, and another said, no, God is acting. So it's a change of direction, different directions. I mean, it's not a small thing in theology, in my opinion. On a general to individual continuum, dogmatic theology is concerned universally, is considered universally valid. It deals with basic principles, and it has an open framework. Contextual theology deals with analysis of a particular situation. And it's interesting that contextual theology is a theology that usually not even claim to have universal application of theologies, and it's understandable because it's just meant for a local situation, for a local context. And I think it's also one of the great weaknesses of those contextual theologies. On time concepts, dogmatic theology considers the whole of time, speaks about eternity and so on. Contextual theology concentrates on the present. So what is now important and so on and so on. On a continuum between ontological and functional, the dogmatic theology deals epistemologically with knowledge or being, and textual theology deals functionally with being. So one is ontology. Ontology is speaking about the being itself. Of course, dogmatic theology is claiming to speak about being of God. In that sense, they are ontological. On the other hand, contextual theologies ask the question, how do they function? It really doesn't matter that much what God is or whatever. I see that I'm a little bit pushing, they say, yes, how it will function. And if that is being put as the most important question, then of course, yes, you will get certain answers to those questions that are raised. On unity versus plurality, dogmatic theology underlines unity. Contextual theology underlines plurality. On the receptive active continuum, dogmatic theology affirms the action of God, that man is being receptive. Contextual theology emphasizes the creative and self-affirming action of man. So you see, again, completely different emphasis and actually the whole structure of theology. can't argue with him in favour of his own eloquently created paradigm. For instance, his kind of arguments are, don't you see in the church history that theology has always been influenced by context? Don't you see? No? Specific nation influences theology in that way, and then theologians as such who made theology are, of course, also influenced by context. He mentioned specifically, for instance, theology which was made after the Reformation. He said, from Catholic perspective, he said, of course, whole theology after the Reformation is shaped by the challenges that the Reformation posed and put in front of the Catholic Church. And then he says, don't you see? Of course, the whole theology has been shaped by the Reformation of Roman Catholic Church. And well, for Behmens, this context reaches such an importance that it really takes place of locus theologicus. Behmens explains that indeed when we say that there are three sources for theology, they are not just adding context to the third element, they are changing the whole equation. So before that, and he's Roman Catholic, of course, although I think we as Lutherans also have certain traditions, so Luther also didn't want to get rid of that tradition that was in accord with the scriptures, and we are a traditional church, of course. I mean, in a sense, we also can say that our theology is made from scripture plus tradition, Evan sees it that there is completely different equation. So now scripture plus tradition plus context, that makes theology. And of course, since context differs in particular country or geographic area or century, of course also theology will differ because of that. It's just pure mathematics. And that's why really we can see that sometimes those contextual theologies are so different from one another that it's really sometimes hard to find any similarities. What is really there? I mean, what is in common? It's on one hand they are claiming to be Christian theologies, but then they are so shaped by the context that it's not really nothing similar there. And of course, as I mentioned, context changes. And as context changes, theology has to be shaped or introduced to new theology. And so contextualizing theology is therefore a free to die. The moment for which they were made has passed. When their time is gone, a new situation emerges with its own issues and needs, new opportunities arise, and a new contextualizing theology will be born. So it's like a really like a race. One is dying, another is appearing, and what will the new be? So I think we really, in evaluating this challenge of contextualism as such, we really need to measure all those pros and cons, you know, what are appearing. And I suppose, and I would be presupposed that everybody of us here are more of a traditional kind of theologian than this contextual one. But on the other hand, it is a challenge. And I think many, especially in developing or old countries or whatever they are called nowadays, theologies are emerging and they are supported. And they are supported by quite bright and brilliant intellectuals, theologically really up to the task. And I don't know how much time I still have. I don't have time.
It's a good point. Deal with some parts.
I have some 10 minutes. So, how to respond to those challenges? First of all, I think we need to be really sure of what we're talking when we say contextualization or contextual theology. Of course, it's all based on work, context. And what does this context mean? The term context is derived from the Latin contextus, the last participle of contextere, which means to be together or to join together. And this weaving or joining together is really a relative thing or approach. It's never absolute. You always weave something together, you always tie something together to something that already exists. It's never like standing alone or absolute. And of course, we as Christians, we always have considered God as being absolute. And somehow, I think those contextual theologies are using the context as a main principle, of course, are putting themselves into this relativity area. I really like those questions. We all use this word context, and quite often we use it in daily, everyday lives. And of course, we cannot command the use of the word, but on the other hand, let's clear it up. Who could answer those questions? How big is the context? Okay, if you talk about context, then how long does one last? What are its main marks? How do you recognize context when you see? The most interesting thing is what Kiesing is saying, that actually, after all those talks, context could be just in our heads. Contexts are in our heads, not out there. This is, of course, challenging also, but on the other hand, really, how can you say that it is context and that is not context, how big it is? And it's really a big notion. And to put the whole theological structure on such a notion, I think it's just, it's not justifiable. Really, context is a matter of interpretation. When you say, you know, I think the context is like that and that and that. What you are really doing, you are interpreting as you think the context are. It may be completely different, but in the moment when you mention this word, context, everybody is listening to you as the main interpreter of the whole situation. And you may be right, you may be wrong, or whatever. But context is always subdued somehow to the interpretation. After all, and Keating is anthropologist. He's not a theologian. And anthropologists are usually dealing with those contexts, especially when observing some wild tribes somewhere in the jungles or whatever. They are putting a lot of attention to that. How can you, for instance, observe a tribe without disturbing the context? If you have disturbed the context, for instance, how can you know that that it is the context that you want to observe, and so on, so on, so on. So it's really the basis are that there really might not be anything based in theology. No? And that's quite challenging. I think we really should be aware of that challenge. When we are also confronted with those contextual theologies, I think we really need to look from that perspective. Yes, as I said, contextualization is not anything else but a matter of interpretation. And two choices. One is we can contextualize according to this ephemeral nature of contextualism and thus being subjected to frequent logical changes, because context changes all the time. Or we can simply plainly rely on the revealed truth as the church has done. How much is it? 1972 years. Okay, approximately, since the notion of contextualization appeared. And so we just, we can just stay with the traditional or classical theologies, including the understanding of the traditional pastoral ministry. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Yes, please.
I'm not sure if I read this, some of the same material with the topic, but there's someone that has raised the issue that the old way was sort of colonial in nature, and it imposed its view on the community.
Right.
Okay, now, did you run across any of that,
Well, it's just standard objections that are raised against, of course, any kind of missionary, and you are just... On the other hand, I think we really need to be careful there, because we are not, if you go to the mission, we shouldn't be really teaching, let's say, all our European manners or culture bringing with us there. And I think if we put too much emphasis on the culture that sort of is joined together with our Christian persuasion, then it can be easily considered as a colonial, type of invasion into their, let's say, natural habitat, on the other hand, if we try to contextualize try to take the very core of Christianity there, and not to bring all our cultural things, if it's possible or not, that's a good question. But usually yes, those missionaries.
Well, I was thinking that the thing was that years ago there was this. Well, what was perceived as being a colonial attitude, we're so much smarter than you are. We know what your problem is. Well, take a look at the church sometimes. You have, like in Missouri Synod, you have these small churches. They don't have a pastor. Now you have people who understand they're sinners, they need a savior, they need what it says in Article 5, we need the gospel and the sacraments, okay? Mm. And what that means is we need a pastor. But then they say, well, we're not going to give you a pastor. We're going to give you somebody else. We're going to give you a lay preacher. Mm. And so my point is that the people realize they need a pastor. But then there's this colonial attitude in a way saying, yeah, well, we know better than you, and here's what you need.
Yeah, absolutely. I heartily agree with you, yes. That might be quite a challenge indeed. Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions or comments?
I was thinking when you started out, I read some of this contextual stuff, and I realized that what they're saying about me is actually more true about them, because when they're talking, you're just dead.
Yeah.
There's nothing alive at all.
Absolutely. Last before the day.
It's like they looked in the mirror and then they said, this is you.
Yeah.
I told you. I think I know what you're going to answer. Do they have some universal, recognized, concrete realities that are in every culture? I know we all have two legs or two ears.
You mean like contextual letters or contextual theologians?
Contextual theologians. Well, they, yeah. I mean, can they even say, if they're going to be a Christian contextual theologian, original sin, how about creator, this is creation, and then can they actually say to a culture, we don't care if you're a Buddhist or Hindu, we don't care if you don't believe in original sin, you're wrong.
I don't think they can afford that. This Stephen Bevans that I mentioned, Roman Catholic missiologist, he's a bright person, really. I couldn't argue inside of his paradigm, I couldn't argue with him. He has established this whole system. I think I caught him in one respect where he compares, like, let's say, five models of missiology. Five big models, and one is Tertullian, another is Luther's perspective, and that kind of approach. And then suddenly he asks, of course, the question is which model is the most appropriate, or most universal, or the best model? And then the answer is, he says, Well, it depends on context.